I'm Norman Wahlberger, and today I want to explain to you a nicer and more efficient way of thinking about polar coordinates. The idea is to replace the usual polar coordinates that you learn in high school with rational polar coordinates, coming from rational trigonometry. So here is the story as usually presented. We have x and y coordinates. That point there, A, is usually denoted 3, 2, because it's 3 in the x direction and 2 in the y direction. Now, polar coordinates provides us with an alternative to describing where that point is. We'd use the r, which is the distance to the origin, as one of the new variables. And the other new variable is this angle made by this line in the positive x-axis. Those two quantities also determine A. In this case, by Pythagoras, r is square root 3 squared plus 2 squared. That's square root of 13, which is approximately that. And this angle theta, you need a calculator to get that. That's tan inverse of 2 over 3, or arctan of 2 over 3. And that turns out to be this in radians, around 33.69 degrees. Those are just approximate values. So whenever we use these coordinates, we generally only work with approximations. So the idea is that in certain situations, it's easier to use r and theta as coordinates rather than x and y. Here, for example, is an ellipse, which you get by taking a circle and dilating it by a factor of a in the x direction and by a factor of b in the y direction. It has equation x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared equals 1. That's the Cartesian equation for that ellipse. Here's what the polar equation turns to be. It's quite different, a little bit more complicated. There's a square root and cosquareds and sine squareds also. But sometimes the polar equation is much simpler. For example, in the trisectrix, that curve that we looked at in the last video, the polar form for it is very simple. It's r equals 2a cos theta plus a. So it gives us the relationship between r and theta. If we know theta, we can calculate r. If we know r, we can calculate theta, more or less. Now let's have a look at a better alternative to this usual setup using rational trigonometry. So here's the same setup as before. The x and y coordinates are point A, 3, 2. Now what we're going to do is we're going to introduce two different quantities to describe this position. We're going to look at the quadrants Q between A and the origin. The quadrants, I remind you, is just the square of the distance. In this case, Q is just 13 by Pythagoras, 3 squared plus 2 squared. To replace the angle, we're going to, of course, use a spread. But I'm not going to use the spread there that you might first think. I want to rather use the spread from the vertical. There are good reasons for that. That corresponds more to what people in navigation do, what surveyors do, and what engineers do. And it turns out that when you go to higher dimensions, that's a more natural choice, because up is a preferred direction to human beings rather than right. So we prefer to measure things from the vertical rather than arbitrarily from the right. So that's a spread S. There's the quadrants Q, and S together with Q are what we call rational polar coordinates. What's the spread S in this example? Well, it's the opposite quadrants, which is 3 squared, it's 9, divided by the hypotenuse quadrants of 13. So the spread is 9 thirteenths. Now, one slight disadvantage with this method is that to fully specify the position of this point, we need some more information. And that's because the same two quantities, S and Q, describe not only this point, but also these other three points here. Just you get by reflecting. Because the spread is only measured between two lines, so those two lines have the same spread. And so those four points all have the same rational polar coordinates. So we need to augment things with choice of quadrants. That's a positive quadrant. X and Y are both positive. This is the plus minus quadrant. X is positive, Y is negative. This is the negative plus, and this is the negative negative quadrant. So in general, the setup is that the quadrants Q, in terms of the X and Y coordinate, is given by X squared plus Y squared. And the spread S is x squared divided by x squared plus y squared. If we want to solve for x and y in terms of S and Q, well, it's easy. From here, x squared equals this, which is Q times S. There, x squared equals S times Q. And then from here, y squared equals Q minus x squared, so 1 minus S times Q. To get x and y, you then need to take one further square root with possible plus or minus signs depending on what quadrant you are in. So as an example, that ellipse that we were talking about earlier that has this as its Cartesian equation, it's very simple exercise for you to plug these things in here and replace the x's and y's with s and q. It helps to replace the a squared with a capital A and b squared with a capital B, which are more in the spirit of quadrants. And then we get the following relation, that S equals capital A times Q minus B divided by Q times A minus B. The lemniscate is a fascinating curve, looks like a figure eight, and it's very important both for historical purposes and its connection with elliptic functions. Its Cartesian equation is given by this, it's a quadric curve of degree 4 in x and y. And it turns out that its polar equation is relatively simple. It's r squared equals cosine 2 theta. It's, again, an easy exercise to just use the relations on the previous slide to replace the x's and y's with s's and q and get the rational polar form, which is even simpler. S equals q plus 1 over 2. This is a good indication that the rational polar coordinates are really hitting the nail on the head when it comes to understanding the lemniscate. Now let's have a look at the trisectrix that we discussed in the previous video. So here is a picture of the trisectrix. It's this green curve right here. Here's the reference circle. We'll assume that the radius quadrants is capital A. And I remind you that the way we get the trisectrix is we choose a line emanating from here and see where it intersects that circle E. And then from E, we go mark off on either side of this line an equal segment to the radius. So that's quadrants A, and that's quadrants A to get the point D and F. And then as E varies, D and F go around the trisectrix. So let's consider this point here with spread S from the vertical and quadrants Q. What is the relationship between S and Q? Well, if this is S, spread S, and that's spread 1 minus S. And this is a right triangle because that's a diameter of a circle, so that's right. That means that's also spread S. So the quadrants between O and E divided by the hypotenuse quadrants here, which is 4A, is the spread S, telling us that the quadrants between O and E is 4 times S times capital A. Now, if we look at these three points here, they're collinear points. That quadrant is Q, that quadrant is capital A, and that quadrant, the big one, is 4 times S times A. Those three quadrants have to satisfy the triple quad formula. There's the triple quad formula. Q plus A minus 4SA all squared equals 4 times QA. Well, it's easy to rewrite that. Divide by 4a squared on both sides, then this becomes s minus q plus a over 4a all squared, and the right hand side becomes q over 4a. And that's a rational polar form for the trisectrix. It's notable because it doesn't involve any transcendental functions. That's of degree 2. Next time, I'm going to introduce a whole new branch of geometry. We're heading towards understanding hyperbolic and spherical geometries. Before we get there, I have to tell you about projective geometry, an old and very, very beautiful subject. Next time we'll start that. I hope you'll join me. I'm Norman Wahlberger. Thanks for listening.